program and you have been regularly participating in this program. As you know, Thought Cafe is a series of lectures which AICCRICED, which is the incubator of the Coffee Board, has been arranging so that stalwarts of the industry can come in and inspire them to think.
We have lost you. We have lost you, Vaibhav. We can't hear you.
Am I clear now, ma'am? Can you hear me now?
We can't hear you.
Well,
we lost you, Vaibhav.
I could hear.
Vaibhav, we can hear you.
We can hear.
Vaibhav, we can hear you.
Oh, but I can't hear. So anyway, now I can hear you, Vaibhav.
Okay, that's wonderful, ma'am. As I said, this program was actually planned to inspire people to look into the different aspects of the coffee sector, the new trends in it, or the new insights in it, so that it can inspire people to get into entrepreneurship in either taking up the new challenge or actually exploring new opportunities as such. You know, it gives me a great pleasure to introduce today's speaker, because she is a stalwart in many many ways. She's a trendsetter. She was part of the Coffee Board till 1995 before she retired as the director of the quality division of Coffee Board. She was with us. She was a Coffee Board employee, and she has gone on to do multiple things after that. She's a world renowned expert in coffee quality. She is actually she's a director on the advisory committee of the Alliance for Coffee Excellence. Her journey with coffee has started almost 4 decades ago. She has been across the world. I think there's hardly any coffee which has not tested her palate and has not taken her consent as such. She has carried assignments across Africa, Southeast Asia, and as she's now an independent director on the board of Tata Coffee Asset. She runs her own institute, the Coffee Lab, which is located in Bangalore. She's a wonderful person to speak to, and it gives me a lot of pleasure because that she has agreed to speak on this forum about Robusta Coffee as such. A lot of other entrepreneurs who came to who come for a pre-incubation, the incubation, often ask this question of that we as a country, India, we are moving towards a Robusta as such. But if we do not classify this Robusta as a specialty coffee or a coffee of a class of which can be called as a coffee of great taste, then where are we? So to answer all these questions, to show the pathway for all the entrepreneurs and the growers who have joined in today, I leave the forum to Sunalini, madam. Welcome to the program. The stage is yours.
Good morning to each one of you, and thank you very much, Vaibhav. You have said so many lines about me. It makes me wonder whether I can, meet all those lines that you said about me. But I just want to say thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me. It's an honor to be here to talk to a large number of people in the coffee value added chain. I also want to thank each one of the participants who have registered and who are attending this session. You've taken time off from your busy schedules, especially in the COVID situation. I think, every minute counts. So thank you very much for being here with me this morning. A line of housekeeping. I think I would be talking about the Find Robusta, and I would suggest that if you have questions to ask, we could do so at the end of the session. My request is that for you to unmute yourself, both the audio and the video, so that I'd love to see you. And I would like you to introduce yourself and just tell me of which segment of the coffee value chain that you represent. You could be a grower, or you could be a roaster, or you could be a cafe owner, or you could be an entrepreneur. And I just love the word incubatee. I'm glad, Vaibhav, you didn't say incubator. I'm happy you said incubatee. which means at least, you know, you're recognizing the female gender in coffee. Coffee is very, very male dominated, and I know what it is because I've gone through with it. But today, of course, things have changed, and everyone is all embracing. Gender doesn't come into the picture, not so much as what it was in the past. It's something like the Arabica and the Robusta battle. I always say the Arabica is the male and the Robusta is the female. So coming back to the topic, I'm going to cover fine Robusta. As you very rightly said, Vaibhav, I think we are veering to being a major Robusta country. We're already, the ratio has changed. I remember when I joined the board, the ratio was 50:50. And of course, we are not actually a coffee growing country. We are a tea country. But I think I must say, congratulations to the farmers of our country, the coffee farmers. In spite of all the odds, today I think our cultural practices are par excellence. You go to any part of the world, and I very proudly, you know, I'm able to say, we do this and we don't do this. So I really would like to congratulate farmers on the excellent manner in which they have fought and developed the coffee industry in India. But coming to Robusta, yes, we've had climate change, we've had pests and diseases. The white stem borer has ravaged our Arabica. We're having more of Robusta today. In fact, when I was asking Dr. Babu Reddy, what is the ratio today? He said, unfortunately, it is 37% of Arabica. So it made me sad that from 50, it has come down to 37%. Well, Robustas, we need to develop. As you rightly said, we have a product with us. We now need to develop it so that we can get the price which is equivalent to Arabica, if not better than Arabica. So what I'm going to cover about fine Robusta, I always believe is the coffee of tomorrow. And so today we need to hone in our skills and develop the coffee bean of the Robusta species. After the, just touching a little bit about the Robusta, this genetic material, I know you've all read about it. I know you, all of you know where coffee, Robusta coffee is produced. I'm going to talk about the differences between Arabica and Robusta. I'm also going to cover a little bit about the chemical composition, just to refresh your memory. And most importantly, I will be going into the various factors that influence the flavor and taste profile of the Robusta bean. I will then cover the uses, the cup quality of Robusta. I think all of us must need to understand that the consumer, he is interested in his cup. You know, he probably would like to know a little bit more after he drinks the cup. He finds the cup to be excellent, and then he starts questioning, hey, where did this come from? What is this about? How did you get this coffee? I want to drink another cup of this coffee. So I think all of us need to cup our coffees, and I'll talk a little bit about that. And I'll talk about the usage, and finally I'll round it off with the importance of Robusta. Having said that, I am having some internet issues. Probably that's why I didn't hear Vaibhav in between. So I have my co-host Revathi, who will probably monitor the slides. So I request Revathi to share the presentation with each one of us. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
As you can see, I have categorized Robusta as a fine Robusta. In fact, we tried to get the word specialty for Robusta, battle even to get the word fine affixed to Robusta. I'll tell you that journey a little bit later, but let me go on to the first slide. Now, when you take the coffee, when you take coffee into consideration, just like all of us have a surname, coffee too has a surname. It belongs to a certain family, and the family is the Rubiaceae family, and it is the botanical, it's its genus, Coffea. Now, I just want you to understand that Robusta is also referred to as Canephora. The interesting aspect of Robusta is the fact that Robusta exists in many, many subforms. That's the beauty of Robusta. There's such a diversity of Robustas. You have names like Coffea stenophylla Paris. If you say Coffea stenophylla, it refers to Arabica. But when I say Coffea stenophylla Paris, it refers to Robusta. You have Bucobensis. You have Robusta, you have Ganda strain, you have many, 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 many forms of Robusta, and that's the beauty of it. So don't get confused when I say Coffea canephora, it refers to Robusta. So Coffea arabica and Coffea canephora, they are commercially cultivated. But please do not forget that you also have three coffees, Coffea liberica and Coffea excelsa. So I would like to urge the farmer to even look at these two species. You have it as a, you know, a boundary tree. Now it also you know, stands as a windbreaker. So don't just neglect those cherries. Make a coffee out of that. Make you know, washed coffee or make a cherry coffee of it. But you have to take absolute care because it's not so easy to process Liberica and Excelsa. Probably it's a little more difficult than Robusta. Processing Robusta is more difficult than the Arabica. So in fact, just to tell you a little bit about the Liberica, we processed it on our farm and we sent it to a buyer in Korea and he just loved it. He said it has tea masala notes in it. And today I understand that he's built a relationship with this farmer and he continuously buys. He may not be buying large volumes like a ton of coffee. He buys about 4 bags, 5 bags, but he pays a premium price for it. So just keep in watch about the Coffea liberica and Coffea excelsa. Let's move on to the production. I just wanted to show you the picture on the left, which shows the pie chart. Look at the pie chart. There's something missing in the pie chart. And the country that is missing there is Uganda. This is a pie chart of a little earlier, maybe a couple of years ago. But why I put this chart on the slide is to reiterate to you that there are other countries in the world who are now improving their Robusta coffees. They're realizing that it's going to be the coffee of tomorrow. They're improving the quality in the cup. They're improving the genetic material, and they are also doing the marketing, excellent, brilliant marketing. You take Uganda. Uganda, I still remember when I started my journey in coffee, it is nowhere. The quantity produced was so little and quality was not very good. I did work there for some time. And you know, every little word that I told them, they followed every single instruction regarding processing. It was amazing to see. It was amazing to see their clonal gardens. They took me and they were very open about everything that they were doing. They showed me their clonal gardens and it was mind-boggling to see the number of clonal gardens they have there. And today, those clonal plants are the ones that are doing the trick. They are producing 4 million bags of Robusta and not just a mediocre Robusta, high-quality Robusta. They have now started their marketing drive, and I'm beginning to note that during the COVID scenario, which is still prevalent in the rest in India and in the rest of the world, that you know they have replaced India in Italy. I feel a little sad about that, but then the point is they worked very hard towards it. So now we need to really hone up our skills. We have brilliant material. We have excellent farmers. We only need to know how we need to improve the processing and most importantly, how to market it. We cannot sit in our own homes and say, my coffee is brilliant. My coffee is excellent in quality. Buyer, come to my doorstep and buy my coffee. It just doesn't work that way. You have to go to the market and sell your coffee. Vietnam, that's another country I must tell you. A few, maybe 10 years ago, their coffee was really, I would say, a trash coffee in Robusta's, terrible coffees, but their genetic material was brilliant, is brilliant. It comes from the Ganda strain, which is from Uganda. And of course, you know, it also depends on the cultivation practices and also on the soil conditions. This Robusta grows very well in Vietnam, and if they process their coffee extremely well, you will get some very nice notes in the cup. In fact, some of their Vietnamese washed Robustas taste like an Arabica. Beautiful. But they're only eating problems. But I must tell you, they are on to a lot of programs to improve their cup quality. Of course, Brazil produces, it's the world's largest producer of coffee. It was known as a country which produces commercial coffees. Today, it has found itself on the world map as a producer of specialty Arabicas. Well, the robustas are also improving. In fact, the robustas are called conilon. You must be wondering, why is it called conilon? Why can't they call it robusta? The reason why they call it conilon is because it was found, this material that has come into Brazil is from the region near the river called Quilu. They made a spelling error, called it quilon, and then it became conilon. So it is just nothing but a robusta. Indonesia, it started off producing washed Arabica. I'm talking of many, many, many years ago. In fact, it was very famous in the world market. It was called WIB coffee. It stands for West Indische Bereitung. Of course, the German, Indische Bereitung is a German word. So now you know why it is called West Indische Bereitung. They were preparing washed robusta and selling it from East Java. But unfortunately, they had some issues and they had problems. And now it is dwindled down to hardly any washed robusta. But I understand from them that they're reviving the washed robusta. But do remember, the genetic material is excellent. Of course, India, I'm going to talk about it a little later. Let's go on to the next. I just want you to understand that there are differences between Robusta and Arabica. Very often, people call the Robusta as a poor cousin of Arabica that has got lots of dirt notes, woody notes. It is stale, it is rancid. You know, every single off note that you can think of is attributed to the Robusta bean. But I beg to differ on that. We have some absolutely superb Robustas with superb flavors in it. But just to understand the difference between Robusta and Arabica, Arabica 44 chromosomes, Robusta is 22 chromosomes. Even the plant material, you as a farmer would probably give me a lot more information and teach me a little bit about the plants. They're different. The leaves are different. They're broader. They're pale green in color. And one of the interesting aspects of Robusta is that it can grow both at low altitudes and at high altitudes. Very often people don't emphasize that. But I think in India, we've been able to show coffee which is growing, say, at even at 4,800. I just received a sample the other day from a farm which is at a location of 4-5. And the Robusta, maybe small in size, but it was really, really dense. And in the cup, it was absolutely superb. So you can grow it at both the elevations. And of course, the temperature variance is there. It can grow in hot, humid conditions. It requires less rainfall than Arabica. But one important point you need to note here is that it is cross-pollinated. It is self-sterile. I just want to tell some of the farmers what I saw in Brazil. I saw a row of Robusta, and the next row was not a Robusta, but a row of Crotalaria. I don't know how many of you have seen the Crotalaria plant, which has got some nice flowers on it. And there were lots of bees around this flower. So I asked them, why are you planting this difficulty when you're harvesting it? They said, no, in this particular farm, they harvest it by hand, so we don't have issues. The reason why we are having a row of Crotalaria is to attract bees, which means it increases our yield. It also has an effect on my cup. Oh, that really thrilled me. I said, wow, that's something which is interesting. So unfortunately, in our country, we can't plant another row in between. But maybe you can plant here and there lots of these flower plants so that you attract bees. And I think honey is another product that we're also looking at along with coffee. We're looking at avocados. We're looking at oranges. We're looking at bananas. We're looking at pepper, so why not we look at honey too? And I think already I know that in Cork, there's some very nice honey that's coming up. In Chikmagalur, I understand it's also coming up. Of course, the fruits mature a little later, 1 month later than the Arabica. So let's look at the difference between the appearance of the beans between Arabica and Robusta. I'm sure all of you have seen this. The Arabica, the Robusta beans are generally smaller, but there are exceptions. And here is one exception I must tell you. The bean from Angola, it was called Angola Ambrus and Amboim at one time, was absolutely superb. I remember when I joined the coffee board, we had a huge Angolan delegation coming to, exchange information. They wanted more knowledge from us. And we were happy to share with them the information that we had on Robustas. And they brought me a sample of this Robusta, and I was absolutely taken aback. It looked like Arabica, huge beans. Of course, in the cup, it was quite wanting because they did not know how to process the coffee. So what I want to emphasize over here is that the size of the beans could be different from country to country. In our country, they're definitely much smaller. They are either round in shape, but generally I find that they're oval and they have a pointed tip either at one end or another. And I often refer to it as a catamaran. It reminds me of Kerala and the catamaran boat race. Of course, the color of it will depend on how you process it. If I prepare it by the wash method, I'm going to get a gray or a grayish blue color. And if I'm going to make a natural coffee, I'm going to get a golden brown color. And in India, our Robusta cherry is beautiful to look at if you process it correctly without having blacks and greens. It's a very uniform golden brown color. Caffeine content, I want you to note this as an incubatee. The caffeine content in Robusta is twice that in Arabica, which means it provides you with an opportunity. It provides you with an opportunity in terms of its usage, and I'm going to cover that a little later. So do remember that the caffeine being higher is also perhaps as an advantage to you. It probably you can utilize that. So let's go on to the next one. So let's look at the chemical composition. What I'm going to emphasize in this particular table is the fact of chlorogenic acid. If you look at CGA, you will find that Robusta has got a pretty high percentage of CGA. Now, the chlorogenic acid, of course, it depends on also how you roast it, because if you roast it very dark, the chlorogenic acid content goes down. But please remember that chlorogenic acid is an antioxidant, which means it's good for health. So that's another point you as an entrepreneur should keep in mind. When you look at the sugar content, Robustas have a lower sugar content and it's got a caffeine and higher trigonelline a lower trigonelline content, which means that the bitterness is going to be more because of the caffeine content, and the aromas could be slightly lower because the trigonelline content is lower in the Robusta when compared to the Arabica. Do remember the trigonelline is an aroma precursor. So let's go on to the next slide. I just want to briefly tell you, of course, we have this beautiful story. Please do use this story for marketing purposes. It's so, so great that we have a story. And I think everybody loves to have a story, especially the buyer always asks so many questions about the coffee beans that we sell. You could use this story for even for your Robusta, because one important aspect here is that in the beginning of the 19th century, you know, we had this rust, leaf rust ravaging our Arabica. And the farmer was wondering how to make both the ends meet. And then he discovered that he could get some Robusta from Sri Lanka. And Sri Lanka has a beautiful garden by the name of Peradeniya. And I believe, at least this is a lovely story, I just love it. The Peradeniya name maybe came in from those gardens. I'm not very sure about the authenticity of this, but it makes a nice little fairy tale. So it is Peradeniya, and the official name is Old Robusta, but somehow when I use the word Old Robusta, the glamour goes. So I'd rather say Peradeniya. It sounds so good to the ear too. Marketing, that's all I wanted to say about this particular slide, that we got our Robusta into our country in the 19th century. Now you have to commend the Central Coffee Research Station. I mean, we always try and say, oh, coffee board doesn't do this, doesn't do that. You know, you don't know what the restraints and constraints we have. I've worked there for 20 years and I know how difficult it is. So you have to commend the Central Coffee Research Station. They did some yeoman service. They have launched some brilliant Robusta strains into the market. You know, we have the three important strains, which I will talk about a little later. But what I want you to note is that this development was done due to a lot of difficulties, and that you will see in the next slide. You will see that they had so many constraints and restraints. They found that the Robusta species could not stand drought periods. They found that it was a cross-pollinated. It is not self-incompatible. They found the gene pool limited. They found that they required long gestational periods to stabilize the yields. And most importantly, they had to really work hard in improving the cup quality of the genetic material. They had to improve the visual appearance and the cup quality. You know, it takes years to launch a strain. I mean, all of us say, oh, what is Coffee Board doing? They haven't launched anything. You know, it takes about 14, 15 years to launch a strain. They have to be really, really careful before they can launch. Of course, we did make some mistakes. Everyone makes a mistake. The Catimor that was released initially was not very good. And now they have replaced it with some excellent materials like the Himavati and Chandragiri. So I just want you to note that that the board has worked hard in releasing good genetic material, especially in the Robusta species, to the field. Not that the Arabica were lagging behind. The Selection 9 is brilliant. It's a beautiful coffee. It has got Tafari Kela. It has got Ethiopian strain in it. So again, that was a mammoth task for the research department to launch that particular strain. Now, if you look at the Robusta, I just want to mention to you a very important point. In fact, I was just talking to Mr. Nafees a little earlier before we started this officially. You know, most of the farmers in India grow both Arabica and Robusta side by side. And that is perhaps one of the for Robustas to be so good. We treat them as equals, Arabica and Robusta. Whatever processing we did for Arabica, we followed the same methodology for Robusta. And that is perhaps one of the reasons why we were able to make a foray into the world market much earlier than any other Robusta country. Now, also our Robustas have a lot of advantages. As I said, we have good plant material. We can cultivate it at high altitudes. And the most interesting is that we grow it under shade. I'm going to tell you how shade has an effect on my cup. It does have. I don't have scientific data for it, but there is a country which is working on it, and hopefully that we can get that information soon. We have a very nice diversified pattern of cultivation. We have pepper growing. Today I'm having avocado growing. I have oranges, which has always been there. I have bananas in the region of Tamil Nadu, and maybe it has an effect on the cup quality, but I do know that certain fruits seem to have an effect. And most interestingly, we process today with varied techniques of preparation. So today we can stand very proudly in the world market and sell our Robustas as a standalone branded pure Indian Robusta coffee. And I'm going to elaborate on that very shortly. So I'm going to now tell you what are the various factors that have an effect in either enhancing or reducing the flavor and the taste profile of the Robusta bean. I'm going to cover the plant material because I believe that whatever is in the cup starts first with the genetic material of the bean. If the genetic material is poor, whatever I do, I may be able to submerge some of those not very excellent notes or non-flavor notes or off notes in the cup, but I cannot prepare a specialty coffee with that because it's going to be a mammoth task. My costs are going to be much higher than my returns. So I believe that the plant material, the cultivar, when I use the word cultivar, it's the cultivation, that the varietal which is cultivated is called the cultivar. The altitude again makes an influence. We have seen it in Arabica and we can see it even in Robusta. Again, what is the soil conditions, the cultural practices? In India, I have no doubts that we do it very well. We do it excellently. We have all our calendar of operations, the extension department of the ward, the research have all sort of streamlined our calendar of operations, and we've been following it for years together, and we've been doing very well with that. But shade is something I'm going to talk about. Processing, yes. And again, the last and not the least is the roasting and brew preparation. As an entrepreneur, you need to understand this. You can have the best of beans. You can have excellent cup quality. But if I don't know how to roast the bean and I don't know how to brew it and present it to the market, I'm not going to be able to sell my Robustas. Perhaps it's easier to do it with the Arabica, but for Robusta, you certainly need to understand the intrinsic quality of the bean. Let's start with the plant material. Now, as I said, we have been cultivating both of these species on our farms, and farmers have always told me that the Robusta cost of production is much lower than Arabica. And of course, we all know that it's got a better tolerance to pests and diseases. and also to some extent consistent yields. Because today my climate change has come in and ravaged even that. I mean, I'm beginning to see that there is quite a big variation from one season to another, even in the case of Robusta. But then I find that farmers have said it's much easier to cultivate Robusta. And of course, they also say it is less labor intensive. I don't know how we can say that, because maybe because we just do one round of a fine Robusta or a specialty Robusta, we have to take note that it may become a little labor intensive. Now let's look at the three very interesting strains that have been released by the coffee board, the Paradinia or the old Robusta. We have selection 274. And the most interesting strain is the Congenesis into Robusta. Beautiful, beautiful strain. It has got some very, very interesting notes in the cup, which we are going to now see very shortly. Now I'm going to just make a small comparison between these three strains. If I look at the Paradinia, the old Robusta, the beans are much smaller in size. But please don't get carried away by this, because I've seen on that these beans need not be small in size. It's how I look after my soil. It's how, you know, in one particular farm, he does vermicomposting. He follows the Panchagavya, various Ayurvedic preparations he's using it. He says, no, in my family, we've been doing that for everything. We are two farmers. And the coffee that comes from his farm, the beans are much larger. And in the cup also, excellent. Now, if you look at the flavors of the old Robusta or Paradinia, you'll find that it's got lots of malt, lots of chocolate, lots of caramel. It's just got a lining of citrus, just a dash of orange and lemon. When I come, on the other hand, to selection 274, which probably grows in practically every tract in Robusta tract in India, this was launched in 40s, you will find that the beans are much slightly larger than the Paradinia. Again, I told you that the size would depend on various other practices that you follow. But what is interesting here is there's an addition of two more notes, which is the toasted nuts, the spices. Now here, I just want to tell you that these flavors that you see can undergo lots of variance. Now I could have these intrinsically in my bean, but the way I process it, I can either highlight it or submerge it, or it can even disappear. So sometimes you may turn around and say, hey, but I did see in Paradinia, I did see a lot of spices in it. Yes, inherently it is there. It may be there, latent. And probably the way you processed it, it has helped in highlighting those beautiful notes of spice. So I'm just giving you that what we have observed as a differentiator between Paradinia and 274. And there's a bigger differentiator into C into R. It's got an abundance of fruit notes. It's got but here again, a word of caution, it's how you process it and how you highlight it. I can even have in selection 274, I can even have those fruit nuances coming in. It is there, very subtly present, not in high concentration, which means that I really have to change my processing to highlight that. Whereas C into R, it's blatantly there, so it comes out much easier in the cup, especially when, you know, I don't have to struggle so hard to bring those notes to the forefront. And of course, just to tell you a little bit about C into R, what it stands for, I'm sure most of you know, it is the Congenesis from the Congo Basin. Congo Basin produces some of the finest Robustas. Today, Ecuador is coming up. I just worked with a farmer in Ecuador. In fact, I do a lot of teaching in the University of Trieste, and this particular student, they have students coming from all over the world. And the student was from Ecuador. So she asked me to help her out with her thesis. And she was working on Robusta. She's the only one so far. I mean, I've been teaching there for almost 9-10 years now. And she perhaps is the first student who picked up a dissertation on Robusta. And she was very worried whether, you know, I would be able to teach because of COVID, because she was hell-bent on, you know, doing her dissertation on Robusta, because she has a Robusta, pure Robusta farm. You know, those strains are very different. The plant material itself is very different. I'm very, very curious to know what that plant material is. And so we're working together on that. In fact, she sent me some samples. But what I want to say is Ecuador is coming up. So we are now have to look at some more genetic material. And I'm sure the coffee board is looking at this genetic material. I'm sure that very shortly they would be, you know, releasing some strains. I'm hoping that it will come. But the CN2R is a cross between the congenesis from the Congo Basin and the Coffea canifora or Coffea robusta. Beautiful strain, and I'm going to talk a little bit about farms. I'm going to talk about four farms who have been able to present their different coffees, robusta coffees, as boutique coffees, as standalone branded coffees. Let's go to the next slide.
Dema, your computer must have hanged. If you can just stop the sharing, reshare it, it will be easy.
Okay, sir. Thank you. I'm sorry about that.
No problem at all.
Yeah, so just to sort of cover that, let me talk about Tanzania. Tanzania is also coming up with some very, very interesting robustas. In fact, they are now trying to prepare, their robustas in very innovative ways. And though their production of robusta is very little, I think very soon they would also be another country to contend with. So coming back to the presentation, let's look at the altitude. As I mentioned earlier, altitude also has an effect on the cup. So if you come across a farm where the coffee of robusta coffee is at an elevation of, say, above 3,300 would be a better benchmark. If it is above 3,300, keep that coffee separate. Don't mix it. You know, we always tend to mix all our coffees together. We need to understand that nuance of that coffee, which is at a higher altitude. Because those coffees, they take a longer time to develop. The fruits take a longer time to mature. So the sugar content is higher. And so obviously in the cup also better. You can brand that separately and sell it. So that is an effect of altitude. So keep that in mind when you are, you know, harvesting and processing your coffee. Let's go to the next slide, which will be about the shade trees. Now let's look at the shade trees. This is something which fascinates me really. I still remember when I was at the coffee board, I had a small packet of coffee coming onto my on my table, and this particular person who came in was a facilitator, coffee facilitator. He came and said, you know, I just want you to taste this coffee. I somehow feel this coffee is different. So I tasted it, and it really blew my mind out. It was so delicious. I said, I can't believe this is robusta. And so I went down to the chairman's office. You know, we need to get permissions to travel. So in those days, it was much more stringent. So I just walked in and said, sir, can you give me the car? Can I go to a farm in Cork? He said, oh, what's the necessity? So I said, no, I got this packet of coffee. It's fine blowing. Can I go there and, you know, see what this farm is all about? He was very nice. In fact, it was Philippos Matai. I still remember very distinctly. He smiled and said, okay, take the car and go, but don't go around the town. So yes, so I went to the farm. Unfortunately, the farmer was not there, but we went around the fields. And the coffees looked so different. And the next time I said, okay, since the farmer was not there, I went back the second time. It was his son who was running it. And he told me, I want you to help me out with these coffees. So I walked into this particular field. The field smelled very differently. So I said, why is this field smelling so different? He said, just look up. So I looked up and I found I was, you know, in the midst of sapota fruits. Just full of sapota fruits. The smell was different. So I just struck me, can you give me this coffee separately? Maybe that this is the coffee that came onto my table, a few months ago. Can you process this separately and give it to me? And give me a control, which is a coffee from the next field. I want to compare the two fields. And when I cupped it, certainly it was different. The coffee that was growing under the sapota fruit had some very nice softness to it, sweetness to it, lots of fruit notes to it. And it didn't have that bitterness that we normally encounter in the robusta cup. So I told him, process it separately. You're sitting in mind, go ahead and process it separately. And we need to see how we can process this, because he was not doing any fermentation. He was doing direct washing. So what I want to emphasize here is, if you go to a field or if you are a farmer, you find certain blocks with jackfruits. If you find certain fields, say with the oranges, if you find certain fields with avocado, you find certain, you know, different fruits, keep those coffees separately. Don't mix them. They could be different. Now, if you ask me, is there a scientific backing to it? No, I don't have it. But, you know, it's surprising. There's work going on in Guatemala. It was just in one of the forums that I met these scientists. And when I was talking about Robusta, I was talking about Robusta in that forum. At the end of the presentation, he came to me and said, not to worry, we're working on it already. And he was telling me something about the root nodules. I'm not very knowledgeable on this. He said that the bacteria which comes from the fruit tree, they sort of get on to the root of the coffee, the Robusta, that they were growing Robustas there. It gets on to the roots of the Robusta plant and forms some sort of nodules there. And that seed may have an effect on the cup quality of the bean. I don't know. But I just want you to be aware that even when you have pepper on this particular farm, the pepper plants even twine themselves on the trunk of the Robusta plant. And I find that there is distinctive spice notes, but that perhaps draws a little bit of my imagination because I've been so trees. But let me tell you that this particular coffee, which comes from Balehanur, that side, where the pea berry content is more than 22%, they tell me that's what, because the temperature, the difference in the diurnal temperature is very high. And that is why in this particular farm, there is distinctive black pepper and cumin notes. And today the buyer buys this coffee because of these spice notes. Let's go to the next slide. Processing. This is a very, very interesting subject to speak on. It really makes such a difference to the cup. Now, probably it's the past maybe 8 or 9 years that maybe 10 years that we have started concentrating on processing. Now, when I talk of processing, there are two methods of processing. One is the traditional method of processing, which we always do, which time immemorial from one generation to another, we've been doing it, which is the washed method or the unwashed method. Unwashed is called natural coffee in the world market. Then came a little bit of innovation and we got this pulped natural coffee. They got the semi-washed coffee, which was introduced by Brazil. And today it's called honey coffees. So that came in. So today we have another methodology, which is the innovative processing. We had a very nice presentation, which was presented earlier. I think by Ms. Tapaswini, she presented a very nice presentation on how to prepare specialty coffee. She talked about innovations in processing. I just want to emphasize here that the same innovations that you have done in Arabica can be done for Robusta. It's a lot more difficult, yes, because the mucilage is very thick and, you know, removing it is quite a task. But if you make a washed coffee, which we have, you know, India was one of the few countries which launched the washed Robusta in a big way. Indonesia and Papua Guinea were the first, you know, pioneers in washed coffee Robustas, but they some quietly moved away because they found it difficult. They did not get the price for it, and they felt it was too cumbersome to make these coffees. So India perhaps was one of the first pioneers. I still remember in Coffee Board when we introduced washed coffee, the farmers said, "Why should we make washed coffee? You're not paying me anything more." So we decided we'll introduce this cup quality scheme where we are paying an additional payment for the washed Robustas. And that perhaps did help because the farmer started making washed Robusta. It started with 5%, became 10%, it became 20%. I think today it's 25%. But back again this year, I feel very sorry. We are going back to preparing only cherry coffee because there is no market for the washed coffee due to the COVID situation. Also, perhaps we are pricing. We have to take a relook at our pricing because Uganda is now selling her excellent washed Robustas at a price which is lower than that of Arabica. If Ecuador comes in, if Laos is going to be another threat to us, very close by, some excellent Robustas. I won't be surprised if they have the strains from India, the Robustas, but they are very nice in the cup. And again, they're going to be, you know, they're going to be one of these show stealers, stealing the show from us. So remember, washed Robusta has got a nice profile, but there are some excellent natural Robustas too. They're very nice. Tanzania, elevation of almost 6,000 feet. When we were doing the profiling for fine robustas, you know, we were drawing up the evaluation sheet for fine robusta. I tasted the Tanzanian robusta from a high elevation of 6,000 feet. It tasted like an Arabica. So elevation, and if you understand the topography of your farm and you prepare your according to that, I think, of course, other there could be other constraints and restraints, but if you can make some excellent natural robustas. Remember, the first and most important point is your harvesting. You have to pick really ripe cherries. You need to check the sugar content. Brix meters are available in the market. Via Brix meter, you just got to squeeze the fruit, the drop of the juice into the meter, and it tells you the reading. It tells you whether it's 23%, 28%, 30%, whatever is the sugar content. The higher the reading, the better the taste profile would be. Let's go to the next. I'm going to talk a little bit about fermentation. You know, there was a lot of talk about fermentation really not being very effective. I still remember about 15, 18 years ago saying that there's no need for fermentation. Brazil said there's no need for fermentation. You can just, you know, pulp your coffee, pass it through an aqua washer and dry it. Fermentation does not have any effect on the cup quality. But we in India said, no, we still continue with our fermentation because that method seems to be helping us in terms of highlighting those very subtle flavor notes in the cup. But robusta fermentation is a lot more difficult. You know, you can't ferment it just for 18 hours like we do for Arabica. You have to ferment it for almost 36 hours, sometimes even 48 hours. But during that fermentation, you are able to have the yeast and the bacteria working on those sugars and developing those, highlighting those inherent flavor characteristics of the bean. Now, drying is another important step. Today, we're having climate change. We're having rains, and then it should not be raining. So mechanical dryers have come in. But just a word of caution to all of you. I would suggest do 2 days of drying. Try and see if you can do 2 days of sun drying and thereafter put it into a mechanical dryer. Of course, even the mechanical dryer, don't sort of boil your beans. In Vietnam, I saw smoke coming out of the mechanical dryer. It looked as if they were, you know, baking those beans. So you have to keep the temperatures below 40 degrees Celsius so that you would able to, you know, make sure that the bean, the embryo of the bean does not get killed. If the embryo gets killed, you're going to have a phenolic note. You're going to have a Rio note in the cup, which means it tastes like your maybe something like a cough syrup, even worse than that. So please be very careful on that. After all this processing that you've done, you've taken so much of care with your coffee, you've taken every single thing. How you bag your coffee is important. You bag it in food grade bags, bacteria bags. You also today have hermetically sealed bags. You have the EcoTech bags, rainproof bags. But one important point when you're bagging in these bags is the fact that you have to keep your moisture content within 11%. Otherwise, there's going to be condensation of moisture within the EcoTech bag, and the very purpose of storing it carefully will be defeated. Another important point is please carry out securing only at the time of marketing. It is important. Let's go into innovative processing. If you look at it, there are so many innovative methods of processing coffee. One is your honey. Second is your anaerobic fermentation. There's a lot of disturbance. Can you just shut off your sound? Can you mute your sound? Yeah. So you have the anaerobic fermentation. When you look at anaerobic fermentation, I'm sorry, Vaibhav, there is so much of disturbance.
I'm sorry, ma'am. There is nobody who... Mute all again and kindly unmute yourself as well. Ma'am. I'll be muting all. Um, Sonali ma'am, kindly unmute yourself.
Okay, today I think we are having lots of issues with setting light. Okay, we come to the innovative methods. We have honey. Honey, I think all of us are familiar with. We are doing it with Arabica, so we can even do it with Robusta. You have black honey, you have yellow honey, you have red honey. It all depends on the quantum of mucilage that you leave on the parchment covers. If you leave the entire quantum of mucilage, you have a black honey. If you remove part of it, it becomes red honey. If you remove most of it, it becomes yellow honey. So remember, it also has an effect on the taste. The taste will vary. Remember that the mucilage contains sugars. So it's going to have an effect on my cup. Either I would have intense sweetness or the sweetness will start reducing depending on the quantum of mucilage that I have removed. When I come to anaerobic fermentation, the word anaerobic means that there is absolutely no air. I'm going to submerge it underwater and do the fermentation. So you can do it underwater, or you can do it in drums. You can, you know, cover the drums and you can do the fermentation, either the whole cherry or you can do the pulped fruits that you can do the anaerobic fermentation. You get a different profile altogether. Let me tell you that every process has an effect on the cup. What is double fermentation? I fermented before I sort of aqua wash. I fermented again after aqua wash. So that becomes a double fermentation. But let me tell you, each one has their own way of doing double ferment or anaerobic. There are different, you know, you can experiment. You as an entrepreneur, experiment with these fermentations. You will get different taste notes, and that's the beauty of it. Of course, wet processing, you're already doing that. But there are again variants in terms of time frames. You know, in the wet frame processing, I can do 18 hours fermentation or 30 hours fermentation or 48 hours fermentation. All these you experiment with and you understand it, understand the cup, and then freeze your processing. Today, yeast, you have, I think we had a very nice presentation, as I mentioned earlier, on the yeast, Pichia. There are so many yeasts, it's amazing. You have fermentans. Fermentans is excellent for the cup. You have Parapsilopsis, I mean, it's really mouthful. But these are Candida, that's another family of yeast. Like the Saccharomyces, you also have the Candida yeast. So you have different types of yeast available, and they are also, when you use them during fermentation, bring about certain brightness in the cup. I use the word brightness for acidity. It brings out certain brightness and highlights the flavors. Carbonic maceration. I do my entire fermentation under carbon dioxide. It may be, it sounds easy to say, a little bit difficult to follow, but I always say if you make up your mind, you can do it. So you're doing the fermentation without any oxygen. So again, you're developing a different species of the yeast and you're going to bring about a different flavor, probably a lots of fruit flavors in your coffee. Barrel-aged coffee is, again, a coffee after I process it. There are two ways of doing, but I'm more familiar with the process after you sort of, you know, get the clean coffee beans, the green coffee beans. I barrel-age it. I'll barrel-age it either in a wine barrel or a whiskey barrel, as someone did very recently, and tasted quite good. Wet hulling is from Indonesia, where I, you know, carry out parchment, prepare parchment, but I will hull the parchment when it is wet and dry it in the sun. I mean, it's again, I just cannot believe you always thought the beans will turn black, but there again, you've got to be very careful when you're putting it under the sun, the raking of the coffee, and, you know, making sure that the beans don't turn black. But it has an entirely different profile. Taste profile. It's called Giling Basa. They've given it a beautiful Indonesian name, but it originated from Indonesia. So this is all about the innovative processing. Now, roasting and brewing, that's the final finale for your Robusta bean. You have to ensure that you understand the profile of the bean and also understand roasting. Now, if I were to, you know, serve it in the French press, if I'm going to make a very dark roast, I'm going to have a very bitter cup. So you modulate the roast. You have to understand its profile. I probably prefer to have it as a light to medium roast. Now, I'm not giving you temperatures over here because it varies. It varies from, you know, machine to machine. You've got to understand your machine and then accordingly do it. But I'm just giving you a layman's, you know, feel of what would be good for a French press. But it again depends on the consumer. Maybe there are consumers who like the bitter note. So give it to them. Understand the market. Talk to the buyer. Talk to the consumer. If you have a cafe, understand the customers who come to your cafe. And accordingly, use the roasting technique and the brewing technique. Espressos, yes, I can make a beautiful standalone espresso with Robusta, provided I manipulate the blend a little bit and I can get a great cup of Robusta espresso. I use your Chemex. You know, your Chemex can also be utilized for a Robusta. And you can pair it with so many things. It all depends on understanding the taste nuance of the Robusta cup. And then pairing it, pair it with certain fruits. I just did I just presented three coffees from three cafes recently. It was very interesting to see how each cafe had their own way of brewing the coffee. So I told them, hey, let's pair it with something. So they gave me an array of food. I quite enjoyed that session because I enjoyed eating all their apple pies and their, crunchy biscotti. I really enjoyed that week very much because I had a whole lot of stuff to eat. But what I'm trying to tell you is that you can have to pair it with the right food so that it highlights the taste of the cup. At the same time, the food doesn't get nullified by the bitterness of the cup. So you've got to do a balance. So type of brewing equipment and the type of roast technique that you follow are very important when you present it to the consumer. You have to educate the consumer. That's another very, very important point. You conduct sessions in your cafe. You conduct sessions on your farms. You invite your buyers and you present your coffee, talk about it, which means you have to understand the cup quality of your coffee. So I'm going to talk to you about the cup quality in the next slide. Oh, I'm going to talk to you about the farms. All right, that's interesting. I'm going to present you four farms. Just to tell you how these four farms have made a mark in the world market with just the pure Robusta. Beautiful farms, beautiful coffees. They didn't achieve it through the wave of a magic wand. They struggled, they worked hard. They understood their coffee beans. They understood each of their fields on their farms, presented it well, talked with authority on the coffee, built a relationship marketing. Today, it goes regularly to those destinations. The first one that I want to talk to you is Buttercup Bold. It's so buttery. This was my first coffee. Remember I told you I visited this farm? Growing under the shade of sapotilla fruit. Sapotilla is the word that they use in Latin America, sapota fruits. The elevation is 3,200 feet. It grows under the shade of different fruit trees. And today, this coffee, he is fermenting the coffee today. Earlier on, he was not doing fermenting, but he now ferments it. He sort of experiments with his coffee. He's developed it. He's got a brand. He sells it to Germany. It is sold as a standalone roasted coffee. And interesting, you know, I still remember when I went to his farm some couple of years ago, he pulled out this packet. And here was this beautiful roasted and ground coffee packet with a caricature of this farmer on the packet. And the name was the name of his farm. So you don't ever think that you cannot pure Robusta. In fact, you perhaps will be the first entrepreneur to launch it in the market, especially in the domestic market today. Let's go to the next one. The next, I'm just going to show a few pictures of the farm just to have an idea. You see how he does the sorting? It's very, very important how you sort your cherries. Look at the way he is drying his coffee, raised tables. So there's aeration from all sides, absolute caretaker. Look at the way he stacks his coffee. Nothing is touching the walls. Everything is beautifully packed and kept. So this is the Buttercup Bold. Let's go to the next farm. This is again Harley Classic. This was the presentation that was made some time ago. What I like beautiful about this farm is the fact that they very homogeneously cultivate the plant material of Peridinia. Yeah, it's a beautiful landscape. You know, they've got a lovely little waterfall. They have a very nice homestay now. I understand they also have a homestay. They have a cupping table. And most interestingly, they follow innovative methods of processing. There is a younger, a student from Coffee Board who's managing that. And I just take my hats off to him. He's doing a lot of innovative methods of processing. He loves, you know, working on different ways of processing, comes out with different flavor notes, and is very excited when he comes out with something different. So you have to be innovative. You have to have that curiosity of mind saying, if I do this, maybe I get something else. It doesn't matter if you fail in a couple of times, but if you do it a number of times, I'm sure you'll be successful. Let's look at some of the pictures of this farm. So here you see what care they take. Look at the way the coffee is being dried. And you see that the color of the cherries, absolutely blood red, beautiful. And of course, I think they must have done a lot more improvements. This was taken some time back. I'm sure they have improved on this quite a bit. But I just want you to take a glimpse of the farm. Let's go to the next farm. It's Bhadra Pearls. Beautiful coffee, which comes in, it's called the BHR estate, Bhadra Hills. Again, the elevation is about 3,200 feet. It is prepared with S274. And here again, this farmer carries out so many experiments. In fact, he had some students from Germany who came under a project, and they asked him, can we do some experiments? And he's very open. He says, you can play around with my beans. And I still visit the farm. And, you know, he will say, you can go ahead and try out any experiment. You know, he's so innovative. He wants the coffee to be improved. He wants to, you know, make sure that he makes a mark with his coffee. He wants to build a relationship. And the nicest thing is the flavor notes in the cup, the spiciness and the fruit notes. Just let's take a look at another slide of his. I just want to emphasize the way he does it. You look at this. You look at the way he does the sorting. He sure that it's not on the dirt floor. He makes sure it has the drying tables. He makes sure that the coffee is covered at night. You know, as soon as the coffee is, you know, the evening fall, he covers it so that there is no condensation of moisture during the nighttime. And he has traversed the entire line. He's gone into a roastery. He has a roastery on his farm. He also set up a shop, a little coffee shop called Bhadra Stop. And he's very lucky. He has all the pilgrims going to Sringeri, going past his estate. So they stop by and they have a lovely cup of coffee. And he's got so many coffees, he gives them some snacks. It's so nice, it's so refreshing to have a coffee shop in the midst of a coffee farm.
1,100.
Is that okay? Can I move on? Okay. Now coming into what I want to emphasize over here is, this is the farmer, his image even on coffee accessories. He sold his Robusta as a pure standalone. His face is as a caricature on the coffee packet. Even on the coffee cup, even on the coffee saucer, his face is there. What are they trying to tell you? They're trying to tell you this coffee is absolutely beautiful. And here is the face behind the coffee. So that is what we need to aim when we are developing our coffee beans. This is the piece de resistance of Indian coffee. Brilliant in the cup. Perhaps it is the only Q-certified coffee from India, Indian Robusta washed, Sethuram and Sitara. Beautiful coffee. I can never forget. I took this coffee for the CQI profiling. They could not believe that it was a Robusta. Fortunately, I had taken the green beans also with me. So they roasted it in my presence and we tasted it, and it was brilliant. Absolutely superb. It has so much of citric nuances, orange and lemon. Today, he sells his coffee all over the world, and people don't even recognize it as a Robusta. They say, oh my God, this is something superb. The main plant material is C2R. You can see that even the chemicals, he's got a certificate from the Eurofins, that is a chemical laboratory, which says there's nothing, there are no chemicals in it. He does not use chemicals. He uses everything natural. He does vermicomposting, and he has his own preparations which to control the various pests and diseases. So here again, I just want to emphasize, you can launch an Indian, pure Indian branded Robusta coffee in the market. Now, this is just a few pictures. You can see how the coffee is processed. I'm sure he's improved this again. These are pictures from a few years ago. I'm sure he has developed it even better. Now, I just want you to understand the cup quality. This is something, everyone comes to me and says, oh, but you know, I have never tasted my coffee. How can I do it? Everyone can be a taster. Everyone may not be a professional taster because it depends on your acuity of taste. Some of us are born with an acuity of taste, but all may not be, you know, have that acuity of taste. But it doesn't matter. All of us can be tasters. So what I would suggest to you as an entrepreneur, those of you who are incubatees, you know, form a little group. I think you've formed many groups now. Form a group. And every morning, send one coffee across to your group and say, let's brew it this way every morning. Let's taste it and let's exchange notes. As you know, you build your data bank, you build your palette, you build your knowledge base. You can start somewhere there. And then, of course, go into your professional courses. There are so many courses available today. You can join one of them and better your knowledge base on the Robusta bean. Robusta is not easy to understand in the cup. Arabica is very, very crystal clear. All the nuances will come through very clearly, but not so the Robusta. And that's why I think that's the beauty of Robusta. It challenges you. It challenges your mind. It challenges your palate. You know, you really have to concentrate on the cup. There are so many attributes. It's very, very complex attributes. When I just give you a little summary of the unwashed, when the unwashed coffee generally is very strong in the mouthfeel, and just it'll have streaks of brightness in it. Of course, the flavors, as I mentioned, could be malt, it could be chocolate, fruit, caramel, spices, and nuts. It again depends on so many factors which we have just now enumerated. But I just want you to understand that you can use it in an espresso blend. You can use it in a canned coffee blend. You can even use it as a regular or a filter coffee. Just understand your degree of roast. Understand your brewing equipment very carefully. Understand your ratio of powder to water. Understand your brewing contact time. These are the factors that will influence the cup quality or the taste of your coffee cup. On the other hand, the washed Robusta is more subtle, it's more refined, it's very delicate. It's got some nice brightness, some flashes, it's got some nice acidity going through the cup. It sort of glides on your palate. It's very sort of a peaceful cup. I just love this washed Robustas. They sort of make you, you know, they literally, when you're very stressed out, I love to drink this washed Robusta. It sort of calms you down. At the same time, it stimulates you because of the caffeine in it. So this has got a range of flavors, as I mentioned. What can I use this for? I can use it as a milk-based drink. It really adds the nice finesse to that silkiness of the palate. It also adds to that nice creaminess of the milk. That's the beauty of this washed Robusta. You know, you can make a cappuccino, or you can make a cafe au lait, or you can even use natural energy drinks because of the high caffeine content in the Robusta bean. So you have uses for each type of preparation. Now, I just want to tell you that the mindset against Robusta is slowly changing away. Slowly, there's a lot of research done. They say by 2050, there could be the possibility of, you know, Arabica, you know, with quantity being produced being very little or even extinct, and that Robusta is going to be the mainstay. Now, everybody, buyers are also beginning to understand this. So buyers are also wanting to buy in quality Robustas. They want to include that in their blend compositions. They want to include that in their purchasing power that they have. They want to include it in their catalogs. I just want to tell you a little bit about Norway here. Norway normally does not buy Robustas. Robustas is a bad coffee. It's a poor coffee. It's terrible. It's woody. It's got all the dirt notes in it. Maybe we've earned that because we never bothered about our processing the world over, the producing origins. So I was invited to, you know, to go to Norway and present Robustas, Indian Robustas. So I told this person who invited me, you want people to throw their shoes at me? Is that what you're aiming at? And this lady said, no. I just want these Norwegians to understand. She's a Norwegian herself. She said, I want these Norwegians to understand that Robusta is an entity by itself, that it has beauty and it cannot be compared with an Arabica. She said, don't they understand? When you look at the five fingers of your hand, each finger is different, but each finger has its own usage. I want my Norwegians to understand this because they always keep damning the Robusta. She had tasted Robusta when she came to India, when she came to my lab. So I went there. So what did I do? I took the five most beautiful Robustas from India, the coffees that I presented to you from those farms. I also took monsoon coffee because Norway buys a lot of monsoon coffee. So I took monsoon coffee. I also took Washed Arabica, prime, beautiful Washed Arabicas I took. I presented Robustas in the morning and they said they were going to taste the coffees. And they brewed it in their own. The cupping protocol was followed, but they also used the brewing methodology. They used the Technifon, that is their drip filter. What I did was, I put all the, I coded all the samples and I put the results of those samples in a cover. I sealed the cover in their presence and said, I'm giving it to the leader of that Norwegian association. I said, you keep it, we'll open it after you finish your cupping. So that they don't think that I changed certain things, because that was not my idea at all. I was keeping my fingers crossed. I had to pray a couple of times saying, hope to God that they pick my Robusta and not my Arabica. Anyway, we did the entire cupping. Cupping was over. They all sort of scored their coffees. They came back very excited and they sat down and said, okay, the Norwegian head, please open the cover. Before that, we said, now, we took a little board on the side and we started saying, what do you like? What do you like? Which is the one? And we found that there was one sample which got the highest score, the second scorer, the third scorer. And so there were three coffees which they had scored. So I said, okay, let's open the cover and see what it is. And hey, presto, it was my Washed Robusta. It was the Washed Robusta which stood number one. Number two was again a Washed Robusta. And number three was a Monsoon Robusta. They were absolutely floored. And you won't believe it, but what I like about that whole coffee community is they, you know, we all met for dinner at the next couple of days. They all said, we're very surprised. I think we need to change our viewpoints about the Robusta. We are coming to your country. They were supposed to come in a huge delegation 2020 for our World Coffee Congress. Unfortunately, the COVID completely stopped that. But they're still, liaising with us. They're still trying to say, okay, we want some Robustas, we want to try it out. But I want to tell you that nothing is impossible. Everything is possible. It's the way you go about it, the way you understand, the way you present it, the way you talk about it. And of course, present the correct coffee. That's important. Coming to the World Championship 2008, now the tasting lineup for that, again, we included premium Robustas. First thing unheard of, but they said, okay, let's have premium Robustas. Now I'm going to talk a little bit about the CQI, which worked on profiling of the fine Robusta coffee. In fact, I was associated with this. We were about seven of us from different parts of the world. We were closeted in Uganda. We had Kenneth Davids, who's very respected in the coffee community for his cupping knowledge. We also had Ted Lingle, who was the head of CQI at that point of time. We had the head of the UCDA, which is Ugandan Coffee Authority. We had a person from Brazil. Togo, we had a couple from Indonesia, we had, of course, myself from India, and they could not understand when I was talking about acidity. They said, how can a Robusta have acidity? But let me tell you, at the end of we were there for almost 10 days, at the end of that 10 days, they understood what acidity was. The acidity in Robusta is very different from the acidity in Arabica, and we need to understand that. That is because of the salt content. The salt content is different in the case of Robusta compared to Arabica. But you look at the score sheet. We arrived at the score sheet. Of course, they could not agree to specialty Robusta. They finally agreed to fine Robusta. But what I want you to understand is it's a lot more difficult to analyze. You have this salt acid ratio and bittersweet ratio. It's a bit tough. But you can keep on cupping and you will be able to understand these nuances. So today you have a format, you have a cupping protocol, you have everything in, you have standards, and each country has its own standards. And India, we were one of the few countries who developed our quality standards many, many, many years ago in the coffee board. So we have our standards, we have our cupping format, we have our beautiful coffee beans. The only thing that I tell you is keep tasting and you will be able to, understand this format. Today, the CQI is also conducting courses. Go back, please. Go back, Revati. You have the art grader courses. And I would say that, it's not to flaunt a certificate. Please note that when I have a Q certificate or an R certificate, it doesn't mean I'm the most brilliant cupper in the world. To me, when I have the certificate, I'm able to assess myself. Am I able to make out the nuances like the others are able to make out? What are the cobwebs that I have in my mind? How can I remove these cobwebs? In other words, I'm strengthening my knowledge base. That's how I look at the grader certificates. But each one views it differently. I just voiced my viewpoint. You also have our processing courses, how to process the Robusta, how to process the Arabica. A lot of work is going on, even though the COVID is there. I'm on their board. We are making, preparing different courses to be offered to the coffee community, both in the producing origins. We're now looking at consuming origins. How do I educate my consumer too? So that is something which the CQI has been doing. Not only CQI, you also have the Specialty Coffee Association, SCA, which is now a merge of both Europe and America. They're also bringing out a lot of brilliant courses, especially if you want to be a barista. They have brewing courses. They have very many other courses that they offer. So these are available to you. So I would urge you, please go online and see whether you would like to participate in these. At the moment, they are doing one course virtually, which is the essentials. They're going to bring out the essentials even for Robusta, I understand, very shortly. Use in genetics. Of course, all of us are very, very much aware that Robusta is used in genetics. It was the Hybrido de Timor, HDT, which was found in the Timor Islands. It is a natural cross between Arabica and Robusta. We use that for genetics as a in order to give resistance, pest resistance to the Arabica genes. So it has got great use in genetics also. I just want you to understand that. Now, what I want to talk about here is the entrepreneur. Please note that you can do a lot of things here. You can do diet supplements, mainly because of the caffeine and the chlorogenic acid that is present in the Robusta. You can use it for isotonic drinks. You can make those natural energy drinks. You can make the isotonic drinks where you put in the vitamins into the drink, make some nice drink, but you have to innovate. You have to have an open mind. You have to be very adventurous. Now, what is the most interesting point is in cosmetics. I find that it is anti-aging. You know, it's an anti-aging, it's a skin vitalizer because of the caffeine and chlorogenic acid. So look at it, see whether you can, you know, do something on this arena and probably market it. In fact, I've seen some very nice coffee kits that has been sold for in the market. And I understand Chikmagalur, there is some young lady who's also brought in some creams and soaps and lotions. But I would say, let's look at pure Robusta and see what we can do with a pure Robusta and see how we can increase the consumption of Robusta. Maybe even in a lipstick. I see even lipstick over here. I'm quite fascinated on that. So let's go on to the... I just want you to know that the importance of Robusta. Now, using only Arabica, I'm beginning to find, it certainly limits the diversity of coffees. Imagine if you only had Arabica to as a product to be drunk. You have a limitation in the diversity of the products that are available. Robusta adds the charm. It adds that nice punch and verve to your coffee cup. Imagine if it was not there. I think Robusta has done a great deal to the coffee cup. Price is a very important point. Again, your cost of production is much less. So think about it very clearly. You would probably, I would say, don't remove all your Arabica. Please don't make that error. You need to have both. You need to have a basket to offer. Who knows, maybe Arabica would go up and the Robusta would go down or vice versa. So never ever remove. I know farmers always complain to me, the cost is so high. What are you asking us to retain the Arabica? But please retain your Arabica. Retain a certain percentage. Don't remove all your Arabica and make it a pure Robusta. No, it's a really a no-no in my opinion. Now, I find that Robustas are traditionally cheaper than Arabica. So certainly your premium Robusta can replace a premium Arabica. So that is of great importance to you that it can replace some of the premium Arabicas in a blend. Now, one of the important points that you need to keep in mind is the consumer has never rejected a Robusta. Probably he doesn't even know he's drinking a quality Robusta coffee cup. So he's never rejected it. So why do we assume that this coffee will never do well in the market? It all depends on how you educate him, how you present it, how you roast it, how you brew it, and how you talk about it. So marketing is very important. It's a really, really important. And education is another big basket that you need to keep in mind. Just remember that even before we talked about gourmet coffee, specialty coffees, third wave coffee, fourth wave coffee, fifth wave, I don't know whether we are in the sixth wave now. We have many, many, many waves coming in. We had monsoon robustus from India, which is doing very well. It's even now it's doing very well. Just cupped a monsoon robusta. It had lots of black pepper. It had cumin. It had cinnamon in it. Brilliant. This is from one of the famous processors in Mangalore. This coffee came for, he's exporting it, and he just wanted a certificate for it. Beautiful coffees. I don't know what he does, but he does magic to his beans. And the cup was absolutely fascinating. If you ask me, initially, I hated monsoon coffee. I said, oh my God, it tastes like some straw or some hay. How can people pay an extra price for it? But as I started dwelling deeper and deeper into the cup, I realized it was so exotic. It was absolutely mesmerizing, those mellow notes of the various flavors. It's just that I couldn't understand that cup. So when you don't understand the cup, you sort of down it. So you need to explain the cup to the buyer, the roaster, or even the consumer. We have the, I already talked about the Papua and the Western WIB coffees from Indonesia. Even before gourmet and specialty, these were already in the market. So just to round up, I just want to tell you that we may have treated it as a bulk commodity till very recently, but this is really, really changing. And I just want to put it in a nutshell in the next slide. You that these are the various factors that you need to keep in mind. You need to keep in mind the genetic material, because each genetic material has its own cup nuances. Of course, correct cultivation practices. You have to innovate in your processing techniques. You have to present your coffee well. You have to market it through also through education. And you can have a really, really fine, robusta bean. And mind you, when you have a fine robusta bean, which is, I believe, will be the coffee of tomorrow, you're going to give a good livelihood to the farmer. And you as an entrepreneur, you're going to have very rewarding opportunities. And at the same time, you're going to actually invigorate the consumer to demand for a fine robusta coffee. Thank you very much for your very patient listening. I will throw the floor open to the participants. As I mentioned earlier, if you have any question, please unmute yourself. I'd like to see you. I'd like you to introduce yourself tell me and ask the question. So Revati, you can. Yeah. Thanks very much, Vaibha. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. The thanks should be from my side, not from your side. It was a brilliant presentation, ma'am, as expected. It has paved the way and given a lot of hope, because it is coming from your side that they can still demand a premium in the segments which was only commanded by Arabica. So the planning has to be done. Your presentation has paved the way. Thank you so much, ma'am.
This is Nafis. Can you throw some more light on...
Yourself, Mr. Nafis? Can you unmute yourself, both the video and audio? I'd love to see you. Can I see you? Yeah, okay. Yes, Mr. Nafis.
Can you throw some more light on Excelsa?
Okay. Coffea Excelsa. What I want to tell about Coffea Excelsa, it's got very, very thick sugars. It's a smaller bean than the Liberica. It has got a different shape also. Now, what is very nauseating, perhaps, to a person who, harvests it and processes, it's got a very viney note. It's got a very viney, a strong note in it. But if I prepare it by the washed method, if I ferment that coffee, if I do my traditional method of processing it by fermenting it and then washing it and then drying it, I remove some of those very, very strong vininess, which sometimes can border on a phenolic note. So this Excelsa, even if you have 2 bags and 3 bags, experiment with the time frame for fermentation. You can probably see whether you require 36 hours or 48 hours or 60 hours. You can experiment with that. helps. The cup really improves. It's got a very nice peppery tone at the end, and in the front end would be lots of fruit tones. It will have a little bit of red wine in it. So this is a coffee which is quite different, but you need to innovate, you need to experiment with it and present it with the correct notes in the cup. Have I been able to answer your question?
Madam, I have what 40 to 45 years old, old Arabica plant, and then able to market those beans.
Are you talking of Arabica or Robusta?
Old Robusta.
You have 45 to 50 years. I think most of our farms have 45 to 50, if not even 80 years old. Yes, how do I market it? Now, you have to first understand, you know, the genetic material. Is that a selection 274 or is it a old Robusta or is it a C2R?
It's old Robusta.
Okay, it's old Robusta, right. Okay, if it's old Robusta, you have to first of all make sure that your harvesting is correctly done. Do you wash your coffee or do you make natural coffee?
I wash my coffee. Even this season, how many hours? I wash my coffee.
Okay, yeah. How many hours of fermentation?
No fermentation, just wash and then dry. Yes.
You have to get into fermentation mode. You know, fermentation really brings about such a change in your cup. It's beautiful in the cup after you ferment it. So please introduce fermentation into your processing technique. Start with 36 hours and see what happens to your coffee. It's brilliant in the cup after that. It softens the very bitterness. It softens the bitterness.
Good. Yeah, very nice presentation, madam. It was so much informative. Like we being in the coffee growing from past so many years, still there's so much to learn and from you. Thank you very much. It was a very, very nice presentation. A nice talk.
Thank you very much.
Yes.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Thank you.
The session is open for questions. We can ask questions now.
Manish here with us. Manish, would you like to say something about your Hali estate, which I presented? Okay, I think Prasanna, you were wanting to ask me something.
This is Nafis. I want to add one more thing. Like very recently, just 10 days back, I went to a Hawley estate out of curiosity. I was amazed to see the cultural practices they are following, and then particular harvest, and then then pulping and the drying. It's a very, very high class quality. Educate you, and they are really, really doing a very good job. Thanks to them, they allowed me also. I got a very good insight there.
Excellent. Their coffees are brilliant. They have won so many awards in the Flavor of India Fine Cup. Prasanna, I'm sorry, I interrupted. You came on and then I sort of interrupted. Tell me, Prasanna.
Thank you, ma'am. Let me start by thanking you for a wonderful informative session. Coincidentally, we are starting harvest for Robusta today in state in the Chevreuse region. And so traditionally in our estate, we've never pulped the Robusta. It's always been sun-dried as naturals and sold in bulk. The last 2 years, out of personal interest, I wanted to taste what actual washed Robusta tasted like. So we've been processing it for the last year or so. So today, when we decided to start our harvesting, the question came up, should we process it as naturals or should we wash it? We have, between myself, my father, and the managers in the field, we have a difference of opinion. I feel we should wash it, whereas most people feel that it doesn't really, it's not profitable to wash it, and it's better off just being sold as naturals. Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, you asked me the right question at the right time. The point here is, yes, probably your father and the managers are partly right, because today the market, unfortunately, is not paying a very high price for washed. Again, you guys have taken over paying, you know, selling it at a lower price than us in quality. So I would say don't lose sight of washed. do a little bit of watch, but perhaps this season you may have to go in by preparing more of naturals. But you can make honeys. Why not you make some honey? You can make a honey coffee with it so that you have the best of both. You have the best of washed and you have the best of cherries. So make an in-between processing method. You do a honey coffee and do a little bit of wash, because don't lose sight of that. You know, you can probably supply that to the cafes locally. You'll probably get a good price if your cup is good. There are cafes which are taking in washed robustas. So I think they are partly right, your father and your managers are right, that the price-wise, maybe Robusta Cherry would give you a better price in this market scenario, today's market scenario. But don't lose sight of making a washed, and do think about making a honey. I think that perhaps would be an in-between stage which will appease your father and managers and appease yourself.
Thank you.
I hope I answered your question.
Yes, yeah, thank you.
Vaibhav, any incubator here in this group?
In fact, many of them are here. Mr. Jai Kumar is here. Mr. Sonia Sharma. Mr. Sonia Sharma is here. Somebody wants to speak.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah, this is Manish from Harley. Hi, ma'am. Good afternoon. Sorry, I couldn't talk back earlier because I had a little bit of a network issue.
Okay.
Very interesting presentation for us again, because it's always been a more of a learning experience for with Robusta as well over the last many years. But as you said, there is definitely more demand coming in for Robusta from what we've seen. Also, we've also observed that there is good amount of demand coming for special process natural Robustas also, you know, when you process it in the right way. Your optimism in terms of the demand picking up for Robusta is definitely there, and we've been seeing that. We are also going to do more naturals this year, and I think that will definitely continue for the next many years.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Manish. Good to hear you.
Thank you, ma'am.
I think your friend us. Sorry. Kumar. Yes, Jacob. Can I see you, Jai Kumar? I don't know who you are. I'd love to see you.
Can you hear me?
I can hear you very well. Can I see you too?
Yeah, so I attended your class on the one-day course about 2 years ago. I'm a small-time grower, but my interest now recently is on how do we standardize cultural practices and bring the best of the latest nuances to everybody, on how to level the playing field for all growers so that knowledge gaps don't exist in cultural practice. So last 3 years we're working on that, and we've developed a mobile app for that. We're working with CCR as well. And also we want to promote bio inputs to bring in some sustainability aspects, and also the try to reduce cost of production through biopesticides and other areas. And if we can generate data from the field on when was what activity was practiced, and we can correlate with weather and other aspects of it, it can provide a good insight in continuously improving the process and being more contextualized to the location of the farm. So that's what we're working on. I've actually wanted to meet you. Looking forward to get an opportunity to come over and catch up with you on this and take your advice on how we could how this could help on the long run to all farmers, small, medium, essentially, and then how we can aggregate their produce and take it to the market. I clearly see a lot is to do with processing and marketing, but I feel harvest, post-harvest, and even pre-harvest cultural practices, there's
a
good need for standardization, I think.
Yeah, I fully endorse what you said. I think pre-harvest is also very, very important. The soil conditions actually contribute quite a bit to the taste and flavor profile. So if your soil is not really conducive to uptake of nutrients, I have a lot of malformed beans, and I'm going to have a poor cup. So you're very right when you say that you're standardizing that and having an app. I think it's a very good move. I'm hoping that you'll also standardize and, you know, even the taste profiles, maybe that would be a good move for you if you can standardize in terms of a correlation between the cultural practices, the plant material, and the flavor. That would be a very nice study. I'm sure you can do it.
Yeah, I'm sure you can. But I'm sure that takes a lifetime. I mean, the experience you have is something which we can bring it to the farmers. I'd be happy to work with you. But I surely want to connect with you and take your advice on what you've done and see how we can bring it to the farmers.
Certainly, I'd be really happy to do that. I'm just waiting for my vaccination, keeping my fingers crossed that I'll have it soon.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Jaikumar is one of our incubators.
Oh, I see. Okay. I didn't realize. That's why I wanted to see him. Now I recognize him. I didn't know who he was initially. Thank you.
The session is still open. Any other questions? Otherwise, we will close the session if you don't just speak now.
I can see Chandan over here. Chandan. Hey, Chandan, do you have anything to deal with a lot of roasting?
Good afternoon, Ms. Ma'am. A very good presentation, and as usual, we always have some. Just a few things that I would actually like to share with this particular group. All the things, especially to do with, Palthop Estate, Chengappa's coffee, which is Buttercup Bold. These are all coffees that. You're very right. All of us have relished these coffees, and I know how soft those coffees are. And the only thing I'd like to say is Robustas, we have been seeing a lot of usage in the market, not just in India, but even abroad. And I don't know how I can tell you this, but if I have to tell you that many of the roasters in Europe also have actually started increasing the quantity of Robustas that are going into their blends. It's not that, you know, they are voicing it as such, but it's just that they are being very selective in the quality of Robustas that are going into the blends. And this is something which I would like to actually do that. We need to see to that the coffee is good. And whether it's Arabicas or Robustas, the quality coffees always get their due. And if we can actually do that, definitely have a lot more people using Robustas. And we have a lot of huge Robusta certified people in India as well. And I know it's very difficult, like you just said. Unfortunately, I haven't been able to get there as yet.
No, but, it isn't.
Thank you, Mrs. Menon. It was a very good session again.
Thank you very much. And I think you don't need the Q certificate. Without the Q certificate, you can be an art certificate. So don't you worry about that. You have not knowledge about the cup. So don't worry about those certificates.
Thank you very much, Mrs. Menon. Good to see you. Humble. Thank you.
Good to see you. I have Prasanna over here. Prasanna, would you like to say Prasanna Goody? Prasanna, you won't. Ah, there you are. Can I see you, Prasanna? I haven't seen you for a long time. Ah, good to see you, Prasanna. You're hiding, huh? Good to see you. Very nice to see you after a long, long time. How is the coffee doing? This is from Harley Estate. Brilliant, I guess, as usual, doing very well. Unmute yourself. Unmute. I can't hear you. Unmute. I can't hear you. Vaibhav, any problem there?
No, ma'am. I think he must be using some mobile network. Probably he has to disconnect and reconnect.
Okay, he's doing that. I think he's got a smile on his face. Okay. He's again very, very enterprising, very helpful.
Hello, ma'am.
Yeah, good to hear you. Okay, tell me, Prasanna.
Thank you very much, ma'am. It was a great presentation. Robustas, especially if you do different processing, the results was very amazing. Like we even when you keep in the cup, like it tastes like Arabica.
Yes.
So and like you are our inspiration. Thank you very much, ma'am. When we visited the coffee lab and like when we started thinking about processing, it was great, great of you, ma'am. Thank you very much, ma'am, for giving this presentation, and we are very happy, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Prasanna. Very, very nice to see you, Prasanna, after so many years. It's great to see you. Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you. I think you have Ankit Talanki here. I see Ankit very active on the Coffee Entrepreneur Group. So can I see who Ankit is?
Ankit, are you there?
Yeah, I can see his name. He's one of those very enterprising people who wants to put salt into his coffee powder too.
No, that was, I think, Ankur.
That is someone else, is it? Okay. Yeah. Hi, Ankit. You're very active on the Coffee Entrepreneurs Group. So I just wanted to see who you are. Yeah, tell me. Yeah. So are you an entrepreneur too? Are you an incubator here? I can't hear you. Unmute.
Ankit, you're...
Yeah. Hello. Yeah. Am I audible,
yeah,
madam?
Now I can hear you. Yeah. Tell me, Ankit.
Madam, hi, nice meeting you. And nice hearing to you and then seeing you for the first time. And I've heard a lot about you and your cupping techniques and a lot about it. Very nice of you to have spoken about Robusta in such a nice way. And I am an incubator as well. And we are into roasting. I represent Gayatri Coffee.
Oh, I see. Because you always talk about so many nuances about Robusta, about coffee and roasting. So I was always wondering who you are. You're very fast on your entrepreneurs group. Okay. Very nice meeting you. Nice meeting you too.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you. Vaibhav, who's the one who wanted at the one who wanted at the
ma'am? I think it's Ansu. He just opened his mic.
Okay. All right. Okay. Hi. All right.
I was the one.
Ankur, can I see you, Ankur?
Is it there now?
No. Yes, I can see you now.
Hi. Thank you for the presentation. A lot of what you said really resonated with us. With a group of coffee entrepreneurs that are in the middle of launching a brand. So we are non-traditional. We don't have a coffee background. Different walks of life. So we didn't know about this whole Arabica Robusta thing, and we've been drinking coffee for a time. So we always actually preferred Robusta coffee. Mm-hmm. Only when we started getting into coffee and understanding the nuances, we heard about there's Arabica, there's a market perception that Arabica is better and so on. But we still firmly believe in our Robusta, and that's what we need to promote. Not, we won't only do Robusta, but we'll also be doing Arabica, but with a focus on Robusta. So really nice to listen to your presentation.
Thank you. Thanks very much.
We were initially called Blue Mountain Coffee, but we were advised by a lawyer. It's not a good name. There might be trademark issues. Because I'm based out of the Neil Greens. So we are now thinking of calling ourselves Rupees. Inspired by the scientific name of coffee and kind of thinking about coffee all together rather than any one specific.
Where are you based?
I live in Gudalu. Thorapalli, actually.
Okay. I'm sorry, there's a lot of echo. Thank you.
Usually the connections are not great.
Thank you. Thanks very much.
Wish you all the best.
Thank you, ma'am.
If there are no further questions, Chai Mehta or anybody else, any has any questions? Mr. Jagdish Sunkrit.
Well, I'm absolutely intimidated. I'm tongue-tied. It's such a complex subject. It's even arrogant of to say I'm an entrepreneur in this subject.
Actually, Mr. Jagdish Sunkrit actually happens to be one of our business mentors, ma'am. He is now leading a company to formulate a very interesting crop insurance product.
Oh, I see. So he
trains a lot of young people from IIT, IIRI, and all these things. So whatever skills they have, he's bringing together to form a new product in crop insurance. He's not from the coffee sector, but he's from the agri sector. That is why he's
No, but we need him, you know. We really need him, especially now with climate change. We certainly need him.
Yeah.
I think we started this crop insurance when I was in the coffee board, actually. But then something happened and it sort of didn't take off. But I'm glad that he's back here in full force.
He's actually starting his work on that. It's a private initiative. He's come as an incubator, although being an inventor.
Oh, very nice. That's very nice. I would also mind being an incubator, you know.
Unless the students, we are not going to go anywhere ahead in this subject. That's what I'll get from you today.
Sorry, come again?
If I'm not going to be a student, I'm not going to go ahead in this subject. That's my take from today's lecture.
Oh, I see. Thank you. Thanks very much.
What you said.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Thank you.
Ma'am, this is Ram from Native Arku Coffee.
Oh, yes, Ram, tell me.
Ma'am, really great presentation because I didn't had any idea about Robusta. I've been doing a lot of work on Arabica this side. I think there's a long way to go. There's a lot of learning in Robusta, which I really have to explore and start working with a couple of people on this context. There are a lot of people who are into expertise in Robusta. Certainly want to connect with people and start adding value to the, you know, Arku fraternity here. Thanks for the great presentation, ma'am.
Thanks, Ram. In fact, I want to tell you there's some very nice Robustas in Arku. I have tasted those Robustas. They are high elevation and they are very nice in the cup, provided you sort of roast it really well. You know, you have to, of course, you also have to process it. You have to do all those various steps that I talked about. But then if you roast it well and you brew it well, you have a great cup of coffee. So I would say look into the Robusta too in the Arku Valley. There is some very nice Robustas.
I've actually tried reaching out to a couple of people, ma'am. I think, you know, probably in a month or so, once I start getting some good quality Robusta, you know, then we start doing some R&D on it. Because I've seen Robustas after we spoke, but I didn't like the quality of Robusta and the way it's been done. So I think we'll have to really get something interesting from that side too.
I'm glad I was able to at least win you a little bit over to the Robusta side. I know you were a pure Arabica person because when I asked you earlier on, you said, no, ma'am, I only deal in Arabicas. So I was hoping that, you know, one day I could say, hey, try a little bit of this cup and then tell you it's Robusta.
No, I actually went around to the coffee board in Akupatnam. I asked them, you know, I really want to understand Robusta is right. I think they spent some time in teaching me what Robusta is all about.
Okay.
I think that's when I thought, you know, getting the right ripe Robusta fruits from the right plantation and the altitude will really give me a, you know, better quality on the cup, I think.
Yes.
Just exploring on that.
Very true. Very true. Hey, thanks, Ram. Thanks for letting me know.
If there are no further questions, can we take the permission of ma'am and close the session?
This is Nafis. Madam, can you...
What?
Bird coffee.
What coffee? Bird coffee.
Bird coffee. Bird
what
coffee.
Birds are you... What are the birds that you're talking about? I just love this. Bird coffee.
What happens, like a lot of the birds eat cherries and they drop the coffee beans. We pick them and then we prepare coffee out of that, and it tastes so good. So I have a good lot of coffee left accumulated. So I just want to know about it.
See, what I want you to do now is you have to get it tested also. Remember, it's a bird coffee. So please get it tested in a laboratory. Can you hear me?
Hello. Yeah, I can hear you. Yeah.
So what I would suggest to you is get this bird coffee, first of all, tested for its chemical constituents. Very important. We cannot have any sort of untoward microorganisms growing on it. So first of all, get it chemically checked and food certified. They will give you a certificate that is fit for consumption. So once you know it is fit for consumption, then I would start saying, look at it as a separate entity. Process it differently. You have different ways of processing it. How are you processing the coffee right now? How are you processing it now? Are you watching it?
This bird coffee, what we did. Yes.
Why don't you try and see whether you can make a wash or something like honey coffee.
Yeah.
So what I would suggest to you is, first of all, get its fitness for human consumption. That's very, very important. You have to get that certification to make sure that there is no other microorganisms there. And once you find the cup to be excellent, there's no microorganism growth in there, then I would say brand it and sell it as a niche product. Some time back, I remember from one of the farms in, this was in Sultan's Bateri, we launched a coffee called Kapal Kapi. It was a monkey parchment. So the brand name was called Kapal Kapi. And just fascinating to see how these monkeys used to sit under the Robusta plants, chew it, and then spit it out. But we first got it certified, that it was fit for consumption, and then the farmer washed it. And if I'm not mistaken, it was also being sold in food hall. You know, on 1NG Road, there is a food hall. It was being sold there, but I don't know now what the situation is. But you can do it, Mr. Nafees, provided you get the fitness.
Okay. Thanks, madam. Thanks. Got it.
So I think there are no other questions. I just want to say once again, thank you very much for all the participants. Very patiently listened to all that I had to say. I hope it sort of stimulated and energized you like the Robusta bean. Do remember that it's going to be the coffee of tomorrow. Thanks again, Vaibhav. Thanks, Nandini, for having invited me and for helping me in this journey today. Thanks again.
You've been very humble, ma'am. Vishak, as I said, thank you for the wonderful talk. It has enlightened us and probably inspired many of the entrepreneurs to look it in a very different direction. It gives a multiple outlook into how coffee can be looked at, how an entrepreneur can drive the motive, drive the action of getting the processed coffee, Robusta processed coffee, and branding it and taking it to the market. That's a very entrepreneurial journey which they can look into. Thank you so much for the wonderful session. I wish to thank all the participants who took time and participated. We had a very good number of people who were there in the middle of the session as such. I wish to indicate AIC, CCRI, CED's pre-incubation. Second batch is still open for registration. Those who have interest in coffee, who are aspiring entrepreneurs, who wish to know about coffee, do join the program. It's a 40-hour program where validated knowledge about coffee, the entire value chain is actually placed in front of you, along with the business knowledge and also the legal aspects and other requirements which are required to run a business as such. With this said, I thank the wonderful opportunity which ma'am has given us to learn today. It's a power-defining moment. I wish this will inspire more entrepreneurs to come in this direction. Thank you so much, ma'am. Have a wonderful time.
Thank you. Wish you all the incubators all the very best in their entrepreneurship. Wishing them all the best.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you.
Thanks, sir, Vaipa. Thank you.